नमस्कार। आई एम वंस अगेन ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द भारतीय इतिहास संकलन समिति करीमगंज डिस्ट्रिक्ट वंस अगेन वेलकम यू ऑल इन दिस लाइव प्रोग्राम। एंड टुडे वी हैव वन ऑफ द इम्पोर्टेंट एंड रिनाउंड एकेडमिशियन डॉक्टर सोनिया जसरोटिया। शी इज एक्चुअली फ्रॉम जम्मू एंड शी इन द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ बुद्धिस्ट स्टडीज। शी इज वर्किंग इन द यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ जम्मू। She has completed her PhD in 2008 and on in Buddhist studies. And the thesis, the name of the title of her dissertation was "The Buddhist Art and Architecture of Kashmir Gandhara Region, with special reference to innovation in images." And she has organized and coordinated lots of national international seminars, and worked in Kashmir and Kushana points. Also, she has presented a number of papers in the national and international seminars, and a number of edited books are there in her credit. And the most important one is that she is a visiting professor of ICCR, Chair for Buddhist and Sanskrit Studies in Cambodia from 2015 till date. So once again, welcome you, madam. And we are on behalf of Itihas Sankalan Kalimgan District, welcome you. And the topic, whatever you have chosen today, it is the most important topic, I think, and interesting topic also for the people of Assam, probably, because we are not aware about all these things. But your topic is the influence of Indian culture and traditions in Southeast Asia, with a special reference to Cambodia. And interestingly, I want to say this one, that though there was a paper at our time, when I was there in the college, and Cambodia was a paper, but for the last 20 years, probably, there was no such paper in our that is university's curriculum. So we'll be happy that our students especially can learn something from it. So madam, you can start. And, you can start.
Thank you, sir. I am audible, so you can hear me. Namaskar to all. So thank you very much, Nilanjane sir. So today's topic is the influence of Indian culture and tradition on Southeast Asia, with special reference to Cambodia. So first of all, very thanks to Dr. Nilanjan sir for inviting me for this lecture. So I hope your students and whosoever is listening will be, you know, will get something from it. So coming to the topic, the influence of Indian culture and tradition of Southeast Asia, with special reference to Cambodia, is my today's topic. Before coming to, you know, Cambodia and Southeast Asia, I would like to put some focus on what is culture and how it is, you know, important these days, and it was important in ancient times also, how it you know, influenced the people of other countries and other regions. The conceptual meaning of culture is who we are and what shapes our identity. No development can be sustainable including culture, or excluding culture. Culture empowers and also derives the economic, social, and environmental dimensions of sustainable development. Culture has been defined in so many different ways that one can feel it in is the most undefinable, because in culture we can see religion, in culture we can see art, language, literature, lifestyle, food, clothes, music, tradition, everything. So this is what culture is. Now coming to Southeast Asia, when we talk about history of Southeast Asia or history and culture of Southeast Asia, then we see that the history of Southeast Asia is full of oscillations, or we can say the up and downs are there. In the beginning of Christian era, Southeast Asia was the land of gold, towards which Indian navigators sailed, or Indian traders went there. And in few centuries later, especially Indonesia, become the land of spices, camphor, and aromatic woods. So, culturally speaking, India today is characterized by the more or less deep traces of the Indianization that occurred long ago. The importance of Sanskrit, element and vocabulary of languages spoken there, and Indian origin of the alphabet with which those languages were still written. If we say, agar hum isko Hindi mein baat karein, to bhasha ka utthan ya origin, jo wahan ki bhashaon ka utthan ya origin hua hai, aur unme Sanskrit shabdon ka jo importance hai, wo aaj bhi hume dekhne ko milta hai. Cambodia ki agar hum baat karein, if we talk about Cambodia, Indian law and administrative organization, the persistence of certain Brahmanical tradition in Southeast Asia, and also the presence of ancient monuments, architecture, and sculpture are associated with art of India, and where inscriptions of Sanskrit are still present in Southeast Asia, especially in Cambodia, I have seen so many. So this Indianization, or Indianized elite, if you say, adopted the customs of India, Indian origin, as a mean not only to increase their dominance over local groups, but to improve their contacts with other cultures, but also to legitimize their political control. So these were the things which were important at cultural grafting, or if we say the cultural impact on Southeast Asia was credited to all traders, through which also the adventurers, through which our culture from India to Southeast Asia reached. Hence, it may be said that there's the Indianized culture of Southeast Asia was solistic in nature, which was sustained by the local through the learning of Sanskrit or the language, and introduction of text that dealt with the matters related to religion, rituals, and art and architecture. After getting the footholds during the Funan period, for over 1,000 years, different Buddhist sects exist in Cambodia. Alongside, there was also Brahmanical and Hinduism and indigenous animistic religion. In the end, Cambodians adopted Theravad Buddhism. Even nowadays, if we find some rituals, they are very much, a mixture of Hindus and local, whatever their religion was at that time. It is mixture of that. All religion, all rituals are still present, and I have seen those rituals, and I will talk about it later. This has taken place as a result that over 15 centuries of adaptation and adaptation in which many aspects of Brahmanical Hinduism as well as indigenous religious element have been embraced and absorbed by the Cambodian Buddhism. So if we talk about now, we can see, even nowadays, we can see that in rituals also, there is mixture of Hindu, Buddhist, and the local religious or rituals. There's mixture of that which we can found in even in now. The most interesting aspect of present day religious millet is that, despite being overwhelming Theravadan country, 99% of people, I think nowadays it's 94%. A majority of population is Buddhist, Theravada Buddhist, they practice, but observe Hindu rituals and practices. So Sanskrit continues to be an important language in schools also. And nowadays also there's important, importance of Sanskrit language. They, teach in their schools also. For instance, the role of Sanskrit knowing pandits in ceremony. Now, even in royal ceremonies, Sanskrit knowing pandits in ceremonies such as coronation, abhishek also, in Cambodian king still continues to be a typical example of electric or elastic environment. A large number of local localities were given names, you know, like Sanskrit Tamarpur, Dhruvpur, and Vikrampur. The months also, even now, they use Chait, Vaisakh, Jaisth, Ashad. In Khmer language, if we do research, we have found that approximately 3,500 words are originated from the Sanskrit. Even now, Sanskrit and Pali is taught in secondary schools and in MLN monasteries. Worship of various kinds of spirits, especially Nagas, also is another example of unique case of Cambodian example of diversity. Formation of material and which inspired the creation of temples such as Angkor Wat appears to be have taken from different the middle of the first millennium onwards as consequence of the widespread integration and articulation of Khmer territory of religious and political tradition. Those roots lead to Indian subcontinent. Famous temple, when we talk about temples, the famous temple Angkor Wat complex comes into mind. As if we see the depiction in Angkor Wat is a depiction of Indian flora and fauna, deities and mythical representation have been found. Cambodian constructed huge monument and then with sculptural representation of Shiva, Buddha, Vishnu and other gods from Indian epics and Purans are available there. They are carved on the walls of the Angkor Wat. Angkor Wat is the example. If I say living temple, it is still is an example of living temple where Lord Vishnu idol is still there inside the temple and people do rituals and prayers and they come and worship there. There's one more temple which is Bantesarai, which is dedicated to Lord Shiva, which is very beautiful, built in with the pink colored rock. But there also you find gods and goddesses, Hindu gods and goddesses on the walls. And also, this temple is fully dedicated to Lord Shiva. And the Bantesarai temple was commissioned by king, but was built by a Brahmin who was the mentor of King Jayavarman V. So it was Brahmin who built this temple. So these are the examples which shows that there's the Hindu or the Brahmanical system was has so deep rooted in Cambodia. One more temple is Basak Chamrong and Priyavihar temple. There are so many, I'm just taking the names so that it should not be so long. There are hundreds of temples which are still in jungles. Because of mines, we are not able to reach them. I can only give few examples of architectural and religious influence of India on Cambodian architecture. One is Priyavihar temple. Priyavihar temple is built on the top of Poe Tadi, a steep cliff on Dangrek mountain. It's a small mountain range which has natural border between India and Thailand, between Cambodia and Thailand. So it is the ancient Hindu temple constructed during the reign of Khmer Empire and dedicated to Lord Shiva and was built by multiple Khmer rulers. I mean, it was not built by one ruler, but it was added, so many rulers added in that temple. Yashovarman, Suryavarman the first, and the Suryavarman the second, and many more temples are there. And other example, if you see that, come out with the this one more example is that Phnom Kulen mountain is there, and that is very important in sacred mountains for Buddhist and Hindu. Both It is located in Siem Reap. There, you can find thousands of lingas which are carved on the stone riverbed. And it was from this spot that Jayavarman, this was the place from there, Jayavarman the second declared himself a Devaraj or the God King in 8th century. So Lord Shiva is also known as, the name of the Lord Shiva in Khmer is Prey Eyesore. And it is still, in the tradition of Khmer tradition and remained as protector king along with the Hindu deities. So Shiva is known as protector of the civilization or protector god or protector king. So Kabal's Peyan and Banteshwara is also one more popular site of Shiva, having 1,000 carved lingas, which is also known as Valley of Linga or River of Lingas. There are thousands of these carvings found on the stream down to the waterfall, and this is very important for Cambodian, those who are Buddhist also. Now whole of the population, almost 94% people are Buddhist, and it is very sacred for them because the tradition of getting water from Kabal's Peyan, Cambodian people have that spiritual connection with that Shivling, that it is said that the water from Kabal's Peyan will help couples to conceive, because it is tradition which is coming from ancient time, or they are still carrying it very wonderfully. And it is also seen that many monasteries has Shivalingas and Ganesha idol and in their monasteries and their temples. We also find Shivling and Ganesha idol and Vishnu sometimes you can find there. So these are the things which still present in the society, and they respect it and they do the rituals, and they still think that, or they still carry that rituals, or they still carry that culture, whatever their forefathers has given, they are still carrying it very nicely. Shiva is also related to fertility, so that is why maybe that the water which falls on Shivling, and they take that water as very sacred, and which it is believed that the Kabal's Peyan water is very sacred to that helps. So it also connects the spiritual aspect also. And coming to Buddhism in Cambodia, when we talk about Buddhism, when Buddhism was first introduced to Cambodia, Brahmanical system or Hinduism or Brahmanism was already prevalent in the country. Archaeological evidences indicated that the earliest form of Buddhism was brought into the present-day Mekong Delta during Funan period by our traders, because the traders were followers of Vishnu and Shiva, or they were followers of Hinduism. Even then, they were religiously so tolerant, they were so elastic towards Buddhism, and they permitted Buddhist missionaries to work freely or to travel with them to the other countries to propagate Buddhism and their religion. So in 14th century, it became permanently rooted and was regarded as state religion in 16th century. From then onwards, Buddhism grew in importance and remained the only religion practiced by the Cambodians. This is also Indian tradition, which traveled from India to Cambodia. The two major religion becomes the way of life in Cambodia, and Buddhism still exists and has strong hold in Cambodia. Coming to Buddhist education, when we talk about Buddhist education, the very first thing or imagine, what we can imagine is the world famous ancient university Nalanda, Takshashila and Vikramasala. So highly formalized method of Vedic education helped to stimulate the establishment of large teaching institutes such as Taxala, Nalanda and Vikramasala, which was renowned and known universities in early India's early universities. When Buddhism was introduced in Cambodia, the Buddhist system of education was also introduced there. The method of teaching and learning was carried out in traditional way in the monasteries with abodes or senior monks as teachers of young monks and novice. With the passage of time, Cambodia developed very popular Buddhist institute and monasteries. There was also a rough time when Cambodian history, the Pol Pot regime was active during that time. The institutes were closed and also destroyed. Buddhism was totally banned. Buddhist temples and schools were closed down by the government government of the Democratic Cambodia, which was headed by Pol Pot. Buddhist institutions started developing and rapid growth can be seen after 1993. So general 1993 general election, under the flagship of Ministry of Culture and Religion, the institution, Buddhist institution, started growing. The ancient education system of monastic education is still going great in Cambodia. Indian philosophy is very famous in Cambodia, and I teach Indian. I taught them Indian philosophy at Priyasianuk Raja Buddhist University, and yoga is also very famous in here, Cambodia, which is also an Indian tradition, and they have very it influenced the Cambodian also, and also it is growing. The influence of yoga and that Gurukul system of education Buddhist education system. On monastic education system from ancient India is still going very great in Cambodia, so which is also deep rooted and it is going great. Coming to common rituals which we share, India and Cambodia shares many common rituals. Buddhism and Hinduism become an important bridge between India and Southeast Asian countries through cultural exchange and value-based education. Ancestral festival, which we also, you can see that we also celebrate Pitrapaksh. The ancestral festival in Cambodia is called Phumban, which is veneration to the departed ancestors, which is very similar to Pitrapaksh in India. Phumban festival is early 15 days celebrated Cambodian people according to lunar calendar, and they celebrate in 15 days it is celebrated, and this is in this festival ceremonies and rituals performed for the departed soul of dead ancestors. It is believed that the soul will attain peace by the rituals performed during the fortnight. So this is very similar to our Pitrapaksh, which is celebrated across the India, and also annual festival for the departed soul. So it is also 15 days in India. Also, it is a 15 day ceremony which is celebrated by the Hindus in the 7th month of Hindu calendar. So this is one of the ritual which we share commonly. And the other thing is the Khmer New Year, which is known as Chol Tham Chumay. This is Khmer. New Year, this is Khmer name, day, the Khmer New Year and the Baisakhi day makes the ancient links and strong bond between the two countries. It has never completely vanished or been destroyed from the land. The cultural amalgamation can be seen in many rituals and festivals. So Chol Cham Thamay, Khmer New Year, is the name of the Cambodian New Year, which is usually falls on April 13th or 14th. It also signifies the harvest and celebrated as harvesting festival, similar to Baisakhi. Baisakhi is celebrated by Hindus and Sikhs. So it is an important day for Buddhists also, as Gautam Buddha also attain enlightenment and nirvana on this auspicious days. Another festival is Bon Om Thok, which is named as, which is also famous as water festival. Originated, it is Bon Om Thok is the origination of this festival is a Khmer Thanksgiving ceremony to celebrate the end of the monsoon and kick off the Cambodian fishing season and appease the river. And the water festival was also seen as showcase of military powers with 12th century victories of King Jayavarman the 7th, immortalized the colorful boat racing tradition and adorn upon the walls of Bayon. It is also, you can see the carving on the temples of Bayon and Bante Chamar temple. So this is also famous to showcase the military powers. Historically, the boat race was conducted to train the, if we see the history of this boat race, so the boat race was conducted to train the and prepare the people for war. Through this festival, king selected the champions and include them into the army to defend the kingdom. This is how they choose the best people from the this water through this water festival. And in Kerala also, if we compare it with the Kerala district, in Kerala during early 13th century, war between feudal kings, the king Devar Narayan of Chembakskray ordered to construct the war boat to a famous carpenter, Chundan Vellam. Hence, the technical method of creating these snake boats are around 8th century old in India. So, Vellam Kali has mainly been conducted during the season of harvest festival Onam in autumn. So, these boats which we see in Cambodia and the boat in Kerala seems same, and it was used for wars. Through this festival, the kings also select the champions so that they can include it in army, so that that can be useful for the wars. So this also has some similarity with the Kerala water festival. Whatever we celebrate in Kerala, in Cambodia they celebrate as water festival now. Coming to art and dance, Rimke is a Cambodian epic poem based on Sanskrit Ramayana epic. The names means glory of Rama. The Rimke means the glory of Rama. The earliest mention of this epic manuscript in Cambodia dates back to 7th century based on Vinayal Kantil inscription. So Cambodian shadow puppet Ramayana also is a different type. I mean, there is two types of Ramayana which we see they promote. One is Rimke, the other is Cambodian puppet show on Ramayana. The puppetry is a kind of sacred tradition from the time of Angkor, and it reflects the in reliefs that 7th century Sambhor Preakok temple, Kampong Thom, showing the image images of puppetry ceremony. So it is performed during the sacred temple ceremony or a private function or for public in Cambodian villages. The popular play could include Ramayana, Mahabharat epic, as well as other Hindu gods, and they make the story and they show it to the people, and it is very, very famous nowadays also. So this is also, Ramayana is more famous in Cambodia and it is still getting more popular in there. So coming to textiles, how Sutra connects India to Cambodia. While the fact of Southeast Asia being refers to as Greater India, as we all know, it is well known and documented. There's very famous story, famous in Cambodia also, that in first century Indian prince Prayathong, that Prayathong is a Khmer name, or the prince Konde, who married to Naga princess named Nieng Nek. The name of the princess was Nieng Nek or Soma. The name, Indian name is Soma, the daughter of Naga king. When they married, the King Konde or Prayathong proposed him, and he gifted the piece of cloth or a dress to the princess. So this itself corroborates the historical fact that Indian trade in the area, also introduced cloth to the mainland of Cambodia or in Southeast Asia on a whole. So especially it is referred to King Konde and Naga Prince Nieng Nek. So this is how the sutra connects India and Cambodia. There are also so many, we can see patterns and motifs inscribed in other textiles also. We see that they also take a typical chroma, and which is in India, we call it angocha or gamcha. So this is also still present in Cambodian culture, and also have importance how they wear or how Cambodian peasant worn. And you know, this style of dhoti is still there. So this is all Indian influence we can see nowadays also. So a Khmer, coming to conclusion, a Khmer proverb, there's very famous proverb in Cambodia that if culture dies, so does the nation. Agar aapki sanskriti marti hai, to aapki desh bhi uske saath khatam ho jata hai. So it is very, very, it goes very accurate with the Cambodian people. Cambodia has been seen very hard time also, and underwent through a rough period of from 1975 to 79 or 80, when the country was ruled by a regime, and they come out very smartly and begin revival of Buddhism, and the revival of Buddhism and culture started. So now Buddhist culture and local tradition, also the local rituals, has regained its popularity. Buddhism is followed by high percentage of people in Cambodian population. Buddhist monasteries and monks have been engaged in social service to the people and the nation as a whole. Buddhist Theravada sect in Cambodia, with Brahmanical Hindu and indigenous ritual, it is flourishing. The tradition and the rituals are still practiced in this country, and it is flourishing day by day. This is how India and Cambodia share their culture or share their this is how India is and Cambodia connects, and these are the rituals, and there are many more things which are very fine, which I couldn't add in this. So this is how Indian influence on Cambodia still exists, and it is still in the country, and it is flourishing day by day. Thank you very much. Over to you, sir.
So thank you. And I hope that actually I also learned something for the recent whatever is going on, because on just I in my student life only 2 or 3 pages regarding Cambodia I have learned, and due to I don't know, but
thank
but
you,
it
sir.
Is, really, it was
so
interesting.
Many other things also, because, but that is so minute, which I don't want, because that will be yes. Very researchy type of thing. I just wanted to make sure that people should know what is going on there. Even in India also, even I didn't know. I went there and then I come to know about these things. So it is for the students that how they can take it, and they can take their research, and they can take it as topics of their research, and they can come out with something.
Yes, and another interesting thing is that the fact that the influence of Indian culture is not in our there in present history books, and that's why we the Bharatiya Itihas Sankalan Samiti is trying to find out that which sorts of influences what is there outside India, because we have lost all our interesting points and topics and also the influence. Because these type of histories are not there in our present textbook.
It is there, but we yes. haven't learned it because it was not included in our history books.
So thank you, madam, for giving us time, because today it is a busy schedule for you.
No problem.
One after another session. So from Bharati Itihas Sankalan Samiti, Kalimgarh district, once again, thank you, madam. And thanks. Viewers also, because in the next day once again we are going to meet once again.
Bharat
so thank you very much. Bharat Mata Ki Jai.